Thank you all for coming to this April 2023 edition of the UC San Diego Prepare Institute seminar series. Today, we are extremely grateful to welcome Dr. Lori Crotty-Alexander and Dr. Jorge Masso-Silva. They will be speaking on Of Mice and Men, the Role of Neutrophils in ARDS. So that's Acute Respiratory Distress Syndrome, ARDS immunopathogenesis. So Dr. Crotty-Alexander is an associate professor in the Division of Pulmonary Critical Care, Sleep Medicine, and Physiology at UC San Diego. And she's also the section chief of pulmonary critical care medicine at the VA San Diego Healthcare System. And Dr. Masso-Silva is a postdoctoral fellow in the Division of Pulmonary Critical Care, Sleep Medicine, and Physiology at UC San Diego. So a little bit more about our speakers today. So Dr. Crotty-Alexander completed her undergraduate and medical education at Duke University prior to completing internal medicine residency at Massachusetts General Hospital. She completed a pulmonary critical care fellowship at Harvard and a research fellowship in pediatric infectious disease at UC San Diego. Her research focuses on health effects of e-cigarettes, as well as molecular pathways in asthma and lung inflammation in general. And Dr. Masso-Silva graduated from the Universidad Autónoma de Baja California Sur for his bachelor's in marine biology. He obtained an MS in biotechnology from the Centro de Investigaciones Biológicas del Noreste, followed by a PhD in biomedical sciences at Rutgers University. He was recently awarded a TRDRP postdoctoral fellowship for his studies of lung immunology and inflammation. All right, so I'll go ahead and pause my share, and Dr. Masso-Silva, whenever you're ready, you can go ahead and get started.
And thank you so much for that kind introduction. Jorge, what did you think of his pronunciations?
Great pronunciation, really good, yeah.
Thank you, I did practice, but I appreciate that. just a quick word before we actually dive in. So you all have questions, you know, we do have an open Q&A afterwards, but if you prefer to put questions in the chat, I believe Dr. Crotty-Alexander will be looking those as well. So we will have time for that. So please hold tight and we'll have a good discussion thereafter.
Great, thank you so much. And yeah, Jorge and I decided to do this a little bit tag team. So my lab, when I got here to UC San Diego, I entered Victor Nizet's lab as a postdoc and studied bacterial pathogenesis and interactions with host defense. So that was my first sort of studies of neutrophils and macrophages. And then I moved into airway inflammation, asthma, and then I sort of got into the e-cigarette world. And so that's where over 50% of my research has been done recently, is primarily looking at the immune and inflammatory effects of these new nicotine delivery devices. And so when Jorge was recruited to my lab as a postdoc back in 2019, we had grand plans for him to, you know, dive into airway inflammation with asthma and e-cigarettes. And then, of course, COVID hit and we completely switched over to COVID. But this worked out well because Jorge has fallen in love with the neutrophil and the setting of lung injury, and that's going to be the main focus today. And so we're super excited that, yeah, the work that he's done so far has led to this new postdoctoral award by the TRDRP program. So K99R00 next. So Jorge, go ahead and take it away. And as Steele mentioned, I'll be monitoring the chat box and can respond, or you know, I can interrupt Jorge if I think it's a good question that he can answer right away.
Yes. Can everybody see me? Yeah. Right. Yes.
Looks good. Yeah.
Hi there. Hold on, just let me move this. There you go. Okay, so Dr. Seal already mentioned the title of this talk, which we entitled like Of Mice and Men, the Role of Neutrophils in ARDS Immunopathogenesis. As you can see here, the logos that we have for the lab, they kind of represent all the stuff that we do. We work with e-cigarettes, lungs, and neutrophils, and we do all this work in mice, and also we do human studies with this. So let me start here. So I'm gonna first, like, I just want to mention that ARDS stands for Acute Respiratory Distress Syndrome, as Dr. Steele already mentioned. So ARDS is characterized by the increased permeability of the alveolar capillary, which is caused by the the leakage of this fluid that is being released from the capillaries into the alveoli, which affects the gas exchange, the normal gas exchange that occurs in a normal lung like this one. And that is the ultimate cause actually of that in COVID-19 patients. And in general, ARDS is the mortality remains really high. It's approximately 40%. And we still don't have like a specific therapies for this. And I'm gonna mention in the next slides why. And the survivors from this syndrome are still, after surviving the ARDS, they still remain with many functional limitations, which include muscle issues like cognitive impairment and other illnesses. ARDS is a very heterogeneous clinical picture. So it has a lot of different etiologies. So it can be caused by, infection, and actually infectious is the most common cause of ARDS, including sepsis and many different pneumonia. But it can be also occur and by trauma, mechanical ventilation, blood transfusion, and many others. For instance, this is a table with a lot of the different etiology that we have for ARDS. Recently there has been identified two subsets of ARDS, one a hyperinflammatory and one hyperinflammatory, that has been suggested to be able to be used as a prognostic and predictive enrichment in clinical trials, because currently multiple clinical trials have failed and being efficient against ARDS, because usually we consider ARDS as a whole. We don't have this kind of a specific classification of every patient to define what kind of ARDS they have, what kind of subtype or subset of ARDS they have. So I just want to show this picture of that was published in New England Journal of Medicine back in 2000, that shows what are the main players or what is happening in ARDS. And as you can see, the two main players, the two main leukocytes that are playing a role in the development of ARDS are the alveolar macrophages and the neutrophils. And if I show you a picture that was published also in New England Journal of Medicine in 2017, the picture hasn't changed that much. We have these two key players, macrophages, alveolar macrophages, which are usually the tissue-resident macrophages that are patrolling, the tissue and the airways. They're like key in shaping the immune response early on, but neutrophils are recruited very early upon the insult inflammation, and they can release a wide variety of inflammatory components that can cause tissue damage. And even if we go to the models that are being created, that have been created after the pandemic, the picture is kind of the same. We have the same two players. So what I'm trying to say, like over the years, over like 20 years or so, we haven't changed much our understanding of ARDS, and that's why we have proper treatments for ARDS. So in terms of neutrophil, which is the cell that I'm going to be talking to you about during this presentation, it has some key functions, right? So they're like essential immune cells that are very important, because those are the first cells to be recruited after microbial insults or like an injury. And they're very good at phagocytosing pathogens, specifically bacteria and fungi. And they're able to kill these pathogens within the phagolysosome inside of the cell. But they can also, secrete antimicrobial molecules to kill pathogens extracellularly. And these include the production of reactive oxygen species, the release of neutrophil extracellular traps, and the release of granules with many other enzymes like metalloproteinases. But in the context of immune responses, there has to be a proper control of these cells, because these cells are highly inflammatory, and they have this key function in clearing the infections, but they can also cause like a very significant tissue damage if they're not properly controlled on time. So, in the context of COVID-19, when we start working with this, I like this this slide, because I obtained these figures from Dr. Shane Crotty paper, which explained why COVID-19 has been very successful in causing all the problems during the past 3 years, right? So This is a normal, infection when we have our innate immune responses, which are characterized by many innate cells like neutrophils, macrophages, eosinophils, all the kind of cells. And they kind of shape the environment, the inflammatory environment for the adaptive immunity, right? To allow the adaptive immunity to come, which are antigen specific, and they're able to clear the infection. But in COVID-19, what we can see is like there is a delay and the innate response and the adaptive response. And in more severe cases, the innate response is extended over time and overlap with the adaptive response. So it's extending the innate phase and it's delaying the adaptive phase. So this allow the neutrophils to be within our tissue, our lungs, causing a lot of inflammation and also destruction of the tissue. So this talk, I split it, this talk in three different projects that are related to each other. The first one I'm gonna talk is our published work, the work that we published in 2021 in clinical infectious diseases, which is about the detrimental role of neutrophils when we did like some human in vivo data and some ex vivo studies with this. So the first thing we did when COVID happened in 2020 was trying to analyze, you know, a lot of different cytokines like chemokine and circulation to see how was the inflammatory status of these patients. And we found that upon enrollment, all these patients have, the expected, cytokines that were elevated, right? IL-6, IL-8. GM-CSF, IL-1 beta, and TNF-alpha. And across this hospitalization, we observed the same thing, but we were interested in IL-8 because IL-8 is the major cytokine for recruitment and activation of neutrophils. So we focus on this one, and when we analyze the levels of IL-8 in these patients, and we correlate them with the Apache 2 score, which is a score for disease severity, we found a significant correlation of IL-8 and the severity of IRDS in these patients. And this is just a different way to present those patients with higher Apache score with severity disease. They have higher concentration of IL-8 in circulation. And as expected, so those patients that died, they had more IL-8 than those that survived the COVID-19. So because IL-8 is important in the context of neutrophils, we assess the ability of neutrophils isolated from these patients ex vivo. We analyze their ability to produce a neutrophil extracellular traps or netosis, which is the process of the production of these nets. And we found a significant increase on the ability of neutrophils to produce netosis. The neutrophils coming from the COVID-19 patients. And we observed a similar thing in immunohistochemistry. We also analyzed the production of reactive oxygen species, which is the oxidative burst. And we observed a similar phenomenon where COVID-19 patients have increased reactive oxygen species production and also increased phagocytic activity. So overall, we found that these neutrophils coming from COVID-19 have this hyperactivated phenotype as compared with healthy controls. We correlate the absolute neutrophil count, so the neutrophils in circulation from these patients with a severity score, and we also observe a significant correlation with suggested that neutrophilia is associated with the severity of IRDS and COVID-19 patients. And we also found that patients with higher numbers of neutrophils have also higher proportion of neutrophils producing more nets, more netosis. And this is just a different way to present it. So those patients with more than 8,000 neutrophils per cubic millimeter have produced more netosis. So in collaboration with Dr. Xin Song from UCSD and her postdoc, Lu Xie, we found we were able to collect fresh tissue, fresh biopsies from deceased patients. And we were seeking to stain for neutrophils and neutrophil nets. And we found a lot of different neutrophils, and these neutrophils were producing nets within the alveoli and the bronchioles of these diseased individuals. So basically the conclusion from this part, and I mean, many other studies have published similar data to this, is that IL-8 and neutrophil is associated with the COVID-19's ARDS severity. And we found this COVID patients have neutrophils in circulation with a hyperactivated phenotype, which was evidenced by the increased production of NETs, the increased oxidative burst, and the increase of phagocytic activity that these neutrophils have. In order to actually find more mechanistic data about this, we have these preliminary data that we're using for a grant. When we move to mouse models of acute lung injury or ARDS to assess the role of these neutrophils, and in order to do this, we did like a neutrophil depletion approach in mice, where we deplete mice with anti-Ly6G. We deplete neutrophils from these mice with anti-Ly6G, which is an antibody specific for mouse neutrophils. And then we assess different parameters like oxygen saturation, inflammation, and total protein and the bronchoalveolar lavage, and cytokines and other things. As you can see here, the neutrophil depletion worked really well. So when we induce inflammation via LPS, those mice depleted with neutrophils are showing no neutrophils, so very low frequencies of these cells and the lungs. So the first thing we did was assess the oxygen saturation upon the LPA challenge. I didn't mention, but this challenge was for 24 hours only. And what you can see is, as compared, when you deplete the neutrophils, these mice have a similar oxygen saturation. Let me put the laser, similar oxygen saturation as compared to the isotype PVS. Basically, these mice were just challenged with PVS and they have similar oxygen saturation. But those mice that have neutrophils, that were not depleted with neutrophils, they have a significant decrease in oxygen saturation, which should suggest that there was an impairment of loss of lung function. While we're looking at the histology of these mice, we found that depletion of neutrophils leads to significant reduction of total leukocytes and lungs and bronchoalveolar lavage fluid, which was kind of expected because these are the first cells to be recruited upon LPA challenge. And when we look at different cell types, total leukocytes, as you can see, there is a significant decrease when you deplete the neutrophils as compared to those treated with an isotype control. We see like similar numbers of macrophages, both in lungs and BAL. It was interesting that we saw the reduction of eosinophils in the BAL. We don't know exactly what that means, but you know, a lot of people, they don't know sometimes what the eosinophils are doing. But we're gonna see. Look further for this kind of a thing. And of course, we didn't see any or very low amount of neutrophils in those mice depleted with neutrophils. However, remember I mentioned at the beginning, the ARDS is characterized by this leakage of fluid and a lot of protein into the alveoli, which is affecting the gas exchange in the lungs. So what we did is, another way to measure the damage of this of the lungs, we measure total protein into the airways, so into the bronchoalveolar lavage. And as you can see, those mice that were depleted from neutrophils have reduced amount of total protein in the bronchoalveolar lavage, similar to those treated with the PVS, which indicate that when the mice are depleted with neutrophils, they have better lung function and they have less leakage of this fluid and protein into the airways. So however, interesting enough, despite that we saw a reduction in total leukocyte, there's not reduction in two major pro-inflammatory cytokines like IL-6 and TNF-alpha, and both in circulation in plasma and then bronchoalveolar lavage fluid, which represent the airways. which indicates basically that it's neutrophils themselves, like they are causing this direct effect on the lung function and not much these two major cytokines via, you know, the activation of other cells. So in conclusion for the second part, I can tell you that neutrophils in this particular model, at least 24 hours, you know, with LPS can contribute to immunopathology and acute lung injury. And although the depletion of neutrophil led to decreased total leukocyte recruitment, similar IL-6 and TNF-alpha are found in non-depleted mice. Data suggest also this data that the damage to the alveoli is caused directly by neutrophils and not by changes in these in key pro-inflammatory cytokines like IL-6 and TNF-alpha, as I mentioned before. Okay, now I'm gonna move to more recent work that we have with this therapy, intravenous immunoglobulin, and its effects on neutrophil pro-inflammatory pathways. All this data has been done in human in vivo data and ex vivo data. So first, I wanna mention that the current therapies that we have for overall IRDS, for IRDS in general, is very just supportive care. So we don't have a very specific therapy like this specific medication that you can very efficiently rescue every single patient. And I think that's due more because of the heterogeneity of IRDS. So currently what we have is just ventilation, and we have in very severe and critical cases, we use extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, which is basically this device, this equipment that is connected to your basically oxygenate all the blood for you and just put it back into your system. And also the use of diuretics for fluid management and the use of antimicrobials like antibiotics for bacterial or antifungals for fungal infections. And also the use of anti-inflammatory drugs such as corticosteroids like dexamethasone, for example, which is one of the most common corticosteroid use in COVID-19 to reduce inflammation in the lungs. So we have started this collaboration with Dr. Josh Sakulas and Dr. Angela Meyer. Dr. Josh Sakulas was running this trial with IVIG, with COVID-19 patients treated with IVIG. So IVIG is an FDA-approved drug that is usually used for autoimmune diseases, and it's been has been shown to be effective in some autoimmune diseases, which kind of suggests their, you know, immunomodulatory properties. So it's been suggested in some cohorts of COVID-19 to be beneficial, but in some other studies, they have shown no benefit or even detrimental effects when patients are treated with IVIG. IVIG has shown to show protective effects in the vascular system, has been before during the H1N1 pandemic, it was shown to be protective as well. And some mouse models have shown to be protective against bacterial pneumonia. However, the exact mechanism of how these anti-inflammatory and immunomodulatory properties of AA work are not fully understood. Sorry. So in the cohort, in one of the cohorts that Dr. Sakulas studied, he observed that IVIG mortality was reduced as compared to controls. So those patients treated with tocilizumab, which is a biologics, is an anti-IL-6 antibody. So it's a neutralizing antibody. It's an IL-6 neutralizing antibody. So which is supposed to decrease IL-6 mediated inflammation. Just I wanna mention that these patients received standard care, and these patients were patients from 2020 to March 2021. So most of them, actually all of them were unvaccinated patients. And all these patients receive like glucocorticoid therapy as a standard care, like to control inflammation as well. Something that we observed in this cohort in particular, and that was very interesting, is those patients that receive early, this is the days that pass before the patients receive IVIG after they got hospitalized. So those patients that were treated earlier with IVIG went home faster, and those that received it later were needed rehab or die from this patient. And it seems that there was not a lot of age-related situation. Even older patients that received early IVIG were able to survive and went home within, I think, 7 days of the treatment, or 5 days of treatment. And also when they assess the PEF ratio, the oxygen, basically the capacity of this lung to take the oxygen from the ventilation system into their blood, those patients treated with IVIG that went home early were recovering faster. And after observing all these improvement by these patients, we worked with Dr. Devi Gonzalez and his postdoc, Dominic Magrosso, and to analyze the blood or the plasma of these patients. So we did this proteomic analysis to see what kind of pathways were affected or were different before and after IVIG treatment. And when we observed, and this heat map will show you, there were like a wide variety of proteins that were increased or decreased upon treatment with IVIG. And when we did a pathway analysis, we observed that neutrophil degranulation, activation, and mediated immunity were decreased in these patients upon IVIG treatment. So that was really interesting for us because we already saw that, you know, neutrophils and, you know, IL-8, which is the cytokine for recruitment and activation of neutrophils, were correlated with the severity of disease. And these patients treated with the IVIG were doing better. And then when we analyzed their plasma, it showed that there was a decrease in neutrophil-mediated pathways. So what we did, we analyzed, we measured some neutrophil-related components in the plasma of these patients. And so we analyzed cell-free DNA and neutrophil elastase, which can be part of the neutrophil extracellular traps, and also IL-8, as I mentioned. And it's not very clear here. We didn't have samples for every single day for every patient. We have samples from pre-IVIG, and we also have a healthy group just to show you that there was an increase in all these markers as compared to healthy controls. As you can see here, it's not very clear. Sometimes the data were, the values were like going down and going up at the same time. And when we analyzed only pre-IVIG and after day five, there was a significant decrease only in five patients. So I don't wanna make like big conclusions out of this because it's only five patients, but unfortunately we didn't have more samples for day five for these patients. And it was a small cohort. But we find a reduced cell-free DNA in these patients, a reduced neutrophil elastase. We didn't find a significant reduction of IL-8 when we compare pre-IVIG and 5 days post-IVIG. Just as a reminder, IVIG was given for the first 4 days. So, and that's when we stopped the IVIG treatment to this patient. So in order to analyze, I just want to mention, like, we're showing the IVIG is showing this, and it's suggesting that, you know, neutrophil might be involved in the IVIG mediated protection. I just want to mention that there are like different drugs that are targeting different molecules associated with neutrophil activity. A lot of these molecules are, you know, neutralizing antibodies against certain cytokines and chemokines that are, you know, that activate the neutrophils. However, just a few of them are specific for neutrophils because these cytokines and chemokines are also activating and affecting other immune cells, right? For example, there are like a few clinical trials addressing DNases like Dornase alpha and other DNases that can dissolve the nets that are produced by these neutrophils. However, these DNases they don't control the other components that are produced with NETs. So NETs are not only DNA, they come with a lot of different enzymes and they come up with other inflammatory components. It's not only DNA, and the DNAs only block the NETs once they are being released. It doesn't inhibit the release of NETs. So in order to assess what is the effect of IVIG and NETosis, we test ex vivo. We use fresh neutrophils from healthy donors, and we analyze NETosis and neutrophils treated with IV with either IVIG, tocilizumab, which I mentioned is an anti-IL-6 antibody, and dexamethasone, which is the most common corticosteroid use in COVID-19 patients. As you can see here, those neutrophils activated with PMA show a dose-dependent reduction of NETosis when they were treated with IVIG. However, we didn't find this effect in those neutrophils treated with tocilizumab or dexamethasone. The same thing, similar thing happened when we treat these cells with nigericin. Just to be clear, so PMA activate the canonical pathway for NETosis and nigericin activate the non-canonical pathway. So in either pathway, in both pathways, we can show that IVIG is able to abrogate or inhibit the NETosis in a dose-dependent manner, while tocilizumab or dexamethasone does not.
Hey, Jorge, we have
just a different. Yep.
We have one question, and I think you've looked at this before, but Dr. Croker was mentioning that there's a fair amount of data that IVIG directly kills neutrophils. Can you comment on whether that could be a component of the results that we saw?
Well, I mean, if I can show you here, there is an old paper that I found out, and that was one of the first questions. I don't have this figure with me here, but I analyzed with propidium iodide before the viability of these cells upon time. I mean, there was not activated cells, just IVIG with neutrophils, and I didn't see major effects on the viability of these cells. I don't know, it has to do with the isolation that they did in that paper, I don't remember, but I didn't see much viability. And we're looking at the cells when we treat them, maybe this figure, hold on, the next figure I can show. So even when we treat with IVIG, a lot of the cells, as you can see, they're alive and they're okay. The nuclei is still like condensated. So they're alive. I mean, we should, and I think that's a good question, because if the cells are being affected in their viability by IVIG, that's why you don't see much NET. It's because it's killing the cells. Definitely we should look at different kind of...
Sorry, I was gonna say, Ben, did you wanna weigh in? Because I thought your mention of the clinical trial was very interesting as well.
Yeah, I mean, IVIG is, there's certainly dose-dependent effects on neutrophil viability reported by us and many other groups. And in clinical trials, when they've treated kids with IVIG at high dose, they get a reduction in probably 80% of neutrophil numbers in the peripheral blood overnight. So it probably has an effect on functional state of neutrophils at lower doses, certainly, but at high doses, it would be hard to imagine how you would get that level of neutrophil reduction that quickly without some impact directly on neutrophil numbers, probably by viability, but that's never really been proven.
Cool, very interesting.
Yeah, definitely. I stay here. Just to continue, we also assess the ability of IVIG to inhibit the production of reactive oxygen species. We observe as well a dose-dependent effect of IVIG. We use different concentrations from 0.2 to 10 milligrams per milliliter of IVIG and ex vivo assays, and we observe a significant decrease of oxidative burst. However, dexamethasone didn't have any effect on the production of reactive oxygen species. In terms of phagocytosis, we didn't find a significant difference in any of the concentrations, either in dexamethasone or IVIG. here is just want to mention that these cells were treated with the IVIG, and then the IVIG was washed away from the culture, because otherwise the IVIG will be opsonizing all these bacterial particles that we were using to assess the phagocytosis, and that will be affecting the results. So we just want to know if IVIG by itself has an intrinsic effect on the phagocytic activity and on these cells. That's why they were pretreated, and then IVIG was washed away from the culture. So from this from this last part, we can conclude that the complementation of a standard treatment with IVIG in patients with COVID-19 ARDS can potentially improve. We don't want to make like a big claim about this, because the cohort is really small. That's why I say potentially. But it seems that it depends on the early administration of IVIG to these patients. Also, the proteomic analysis, which is also preliminary, I want to mention this. We're redoing the analysis with more data, I mean, with different groups to do a better analysis. But so far, it looks like the proteomic analysis shows that IVIG tends to reduce neutrophil-related anticoagulation pathways that can contribute to improvement of these patients. Also, the ex vivo treatment of neutrophils with IVIG can inhibit netosis and oxidative burst, but doesn't have an effect on phagocytosis. And dexamethasone or tocilizumab doesn't have any effect on any of these specific pathways. Well, I want to thank a lot of different professors at UCSD, including Angela Meyer, George Sakulin, and Shin San, and Victor and Atul, and Michael and Mason, and Dr. Gonzalez and Dominic, which did all the proteomic analysis, Nicole Kufel that helped to process all these samples from the COVID patients, and Marge Pakowski and Dr. Carolyn Calfrey from UCSF, which is an expert in IRDS, and Roger Sprague, which is kind of a mentor for me. He's already retired, but he's a great mind in the field of IRDS. And also to all the Crotty Alexander Lab and our funding.
Thank you, Jorge.
And
you
I think that will cruising. Be it. Yes. Yes, sorry. I probably was speaking too fast, but yes.
You were efficient. You were time efficient. So if anybody has questions, Jorge, I was wondering, you had gone down a little bit of a path about sialidation. Did you want to speak about that at all, about your hypothesis there?
Yeah, so I have my hypothesis is that there are, because I'm not an antibody expert, so when I was reading, trying to find something mechanistically, how IVIG was doing this, I know immunoglobulins have immunomodulatory properties as well, mostly the Fc portion of antibodies, and there's some constellational modification that happened to some antibodies. And I found a few papers showing that sialic acid and Fc portion and the Fc part of these antibodies have shown immunosuppressive properties in other immune cells. So I was wondering if those formulations for IVIG, because different companies produce IVIG, right? So some of them have only IgGs, some of them they have IgMs and IgEs, some of them have more IgAs as well. So they have different formulations, and there are they treat patients sometimes at different time points as well. And I think modifications in antibodies, some antibodies that have specific modifications are the ones that are able to inhibit the activity of this neutrophil. That's why you require really high concentrations of IVIG in these patients. So all these patients that are treated with IVIG are actually using a lot of a very high concentration, and their immunomodulatory properties are probably carried out by a tiny proportion of those antibodies that have these specific modifications. We are already testing that. We already bought some of the reagents to try that, although it's kind of complicated because working with antibodies is more difficult than I expected, because a lot of the stuff that we do, of the techniques that we have, use antibodies. So, you know, testing antibodies with antibodies is kind of difficult. But yeah.
That's great. So that was super helpful. Yeah. And Ben Kroger put a cool question in. Will you be looking to deplete neutrophils in different SARS-CoV-2 mouse models?
Yes.
Because the current literature suggests that neutrophil depletion doesn't change the disease course.
Yes, I think that's a good question. And that was our next, that's the next thing we're doing. I'm planning to do that experiment with our postdoc as well, with Dr. Laura Barnes. She has this model, this COVID model. So they're using these humanized mice that have the ACE2 receptor, and they have this spike protein, and they produce these COVID-like symptoms in mice. And definitely I wanna try that one, because this goes through a different pathway. LPS go through the, you know, TLR4 pathway and F-kappa B pathway. So it's very, so now that I see the model working, at least with LPS, I would like to try with different kind of models, like even fungal models, like, you know, Dectin-1 or something, some other pathway to activate neutrophils in a different way.
I have another question.
Yeah. Oh, go ahead, Ben. Yeah.
Yeah, please.
So I guess a comment on the IVIG, that dose that you're showing does track very well with existing literature, and you do see changes in viability probably from 2 to 3 hours onwards, where you actually see PI positive cells. You can see morphological changes in response to IVIG a little earlier than that. But there is a potential to have both, you know, modulatory effects on neutrophil function and net formation, as well as changes in viability. But actually, mm-hmm. the morphology of IVIG treated human neutrophils is quite unusual. It's
really
very different to a apoptotic form of cell death, for example. So it's I think its target is has been discussed in the literature a little bit in the last 20 years. But there's mm-hmm. there's still, I think, a lot to learn about its function in humans.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, no, I mean, IVIG has been in the field for a long time, and they're like old papers back in 2008. So at the beginning, when we started this, I said like, oh, you know what, this is not that novel. You know, some people have done this, but I observed the phenotype was very, for me, very striking and very obvious. And then, as I say, we checked viability before, and it was fine. I said like, and we did different tests to actually see if there was a technical issue, like maybe IVIG is, because we're measuring NETosis by the release of double-stranded DNA. I said, this IVIG come on a very heavy, you know, suspension. I said, maybe it's dragging the DNA, and when I'm recovering the supernatant, that's why I'm losing a lot of the DNA, because it's bringing the DNA down into the well, because it's changing the density of the well or something. And we did all different ways to prove that, and we didn't find any technical reason. So that's why we said like, maybe this is true, or maybe this is right. And again, there are different ways, like how people isolate the neutrophils, you know, what kind of formulation they use of IVIG. And it might be different ways, but definitely, I would love your input, because I can see that you know a lot of these neutrophils, I mean, the effects of IVIG in neutrophils and their morphology and their changes. So, because, you know, I'm not aware to a lot of things of this, so.
Yeah, we've got a lot of live cell imaging of human neutrophils from KD and MIS-C patients and febrile controls, tracking kinetic responses to IVIG and the impacts of different kinase inhibitors or different cell death inhibitors, for example, on that process. On the point about mouse models of acute lung injury here, we're currently planning to develop some SARS-CoV-2 models, or actually any other respiratory infection model in the ABSL3. We've got an inhalation exposure system that we'll be infecting mice with. And we do have a neutropenic mouse model that, so you don't have to treat them with Ly6G, they just naturally come deficient in neutrophils to between like 80 and 95%. So if there's ever an interest in...
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, please.
And then I say we have two other questions. Marcelo, did you want to go next?
We have one more from Sinem.
Marcela from JCBI. Jorge, that was a great presentation. I also work with neutrophils, but also I work with oral neutrophils. What's interesting here is that the early stage of IgA treatment, the early stage showed such a huge difference between later stage, especially in the prediction. It wasn't prediction, it was actual death versus survival. And is there a way to actually do a model where you utilize, for example, net related materials versus live neutrophils? Because the early stage, it seems to me that's basically inhibiting NETosis from your mechanistic work, but one could actually add, NETosis versus live cells to produce NETosis. I'm trying to find out what is it that's really about the early stage. Is it preventing the NETosis or the number of cells, or it could be activation of resolution like macrophages that go clear the NETosis. I'm trying to understand how the NETosis are inhibited.
No, I mean, you mean in vivo?
Yeah.
On the patients? Yeah, so yeah. It could be like many different, because it has like a pleiotropic effect, right? So a lot of cells have the Fc receptors, a lot of cells might be reacting to the IVIG gene, not necessarily only the neutrophils. So it might be affecting the release of other cytokines and chemokines, also that are shaping the activation of these neutrophils in circulation and the recruitment into the tissue or something. But that's what I'm saying. So a lot of people, even when it's FDA approved and people use it in autoimmune diseases, it's not exactly well known what exactly it's doing in the system, in vivo system, because we also have antibodies. So it's kind of difficult to do, to know exactly what is happening. And I think that the answer, as I mentioned before, is that a few of these IgGs mostly have a very specific postulational modifications like CL elation that seems to be critical for the immunosuppressive properties of IgGs, because they're working through the Fc portion, not through the variable portion of the antigen, through the portion that binds to the antigen. So
is this for IVIG? You're saying that this is Fc mediated and not FAB mediated?
I think well, at least the postulational modifications, what I found, a lot, all of them are in the Fc portion. So that's what I think is through that part. And I think there is a paper when they shave the AB portion from the Fc portion of this IVIG and they lost the effect when they use the AB portion. So assuming that it's in the Fc part of the Fc part of the antibody. And that's why I think, it might be the postulational modifications of these antibodies. So if we find out that CL elated, for example, that's my hypothesis, right? If CL elated antibodies are essential, now we can leave way lower doses of these CL elated antibodies to the patients, and we can reduce all these side effects that IVIG has, because IVIG has some effects like induced fever and other things. But I don't have an answer for that yet. It's just an hypothesis that we're working on it. And if there is any antibody expert here, please reach out, because we need some antibodies experts here to do this. So
make sure we get to Dr. Bayan's question.
Sorry, couldn't find the unmute button. Great talk, thank you. I work with fungal pathogens and wanted to jump in when you said fungal.
Me too. My PhD was in fungi as well. Fungal.
Oh, really? Responses. Which one?
Cryptococcus neoformans. That was my PhD with Amaryllis Rivera in Rutgers.
Awesome. So we work with histoplasma and coccidioides. We're in the same space as Ben for ABSL3, BSL3. We extensively collaborate with Ben as well. One thing that I'm super puzzled with, which I'm sure Jorge you're familiar with also, is there's COVID-associated pulmonary aspergillosis, which is actually, aspergillosis is normally seen in neutropenic patients, right, after chemotherapy, and so on and so forth. So it's really puzzling to me that, this is followed by neutrophilia, yet you get aspergillosis Mm-hmm. And, you know, it just doesn't make sense in my head. And I think it's super cool to investigate that further. But what I just wanted to simply say is if you need any aspergillus materials, I'm happy to provide some. You're growing in the lab for the latest. So yeah. So feel free to reach out.
Yeah, that would be awesome. I would love to use, I decided to use sterile models, like no infectious, because if I deplete the neutrophils, the fungal burden or the bacterial burden will be really different at the time of harvest. And that will be kind of, I don't know if the effects of the damage is caused by the increase in burden and not by, you know, the neutrophils themselves. That's why I was using, you know, sterile models. We can use aspergillus extracts.
Yeah. I would totally understand not wanting to use the live one, of course, but yeah, if you need any fixed things, we can give you.
Oh, thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
No problem.
And just to hypothesize a little bit, like in humans, in terms of why they get the aspergillus and like mucor type infections, I mean, most of them are like so critically ill. And like when we're talking about neutrophils, like in general, we think they're probably playing a critical role early in ARDS pathogenesis. And that it is like, you know, weeks into it, by then their immune systems are totally crap from being in the ICU and all the stuff that's happening. So that's how I frame it.
I think because most of these severely ill COVID patients, they've been treated with corticosteroids and they reduce, you know, the activity of other cells that are important for, to protect against fungi. So I think that's also a fact, right? That's why a lot of COVID patients, they get like bacterial infections and fungal infections when they have COVID. And that's why they need to be treated with antibiotics. Like at least over half of the COVID patients, they need antibiotics because this, you know, co-infection with bacteria or fungi.
Yeah, super cool work. Thank you.
No, thank you.
Oh, yeah. Thank you very much, Jorge and Dr. Claudia Alexander for this talk today. I think it was very well presented and obviously well received. So we really do appreciate you appearing on behalf of Prepare today. I just want to briefly share when our next talk is happening. All right, so next month on May 12th, we'll be welcoming Dr. Ben Smar at 1 p.m. and hope to see you all there. But thank you all for attending today. We really do appreciate it. Please do keep current with Prepare. We have a lot of things going on and we're working every day to make things better for everyone. So thank you all. Have a great day and appreciate it. Bye-bye.
For having us. Take care.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye.